Just as the planet is facing its greatest environmental crisis, with humans as the global cancer, remember, a cancer destroys the body in which it grows, well, perhaps the internet becomes the global brain. And through the rapid sharing of ideas, we will be able then to find ways of getting out of this environmental crisis. So one good piece of good news is the IT revolution. Number 16 on the handout, you've got the gene revolution, the life sciences revolution. And notice the speed of change. For example, stem cell technology was hardly mentioned as a major issue before about two decades ago. Remember, stem cells are the basic building blocks of life. So originally we were having to look at using stem cells from aborted fetuses. Now we don't need to do so. It's been found that those of us who are overweight have actually got additional stem cells. So the great value is then that I'm not overweight, I'm simply carrying spare lungs and a heart around my waist. So life sciences can be a pharmaceutical goldmine, for example, as a cure or as a way of preventing dementia, and so there are major financial incentives to do the research. Number 17, then, what are the implications? Australia is usually ready to embrace change, unlike many other traditionally conservative cultures. The new era will be knowledge intensive, and so much more money should go into education. There's a need for education and training for completely new jobs. There are six cities in the world that have now got hydrogen-powered buses. Five are in Western Europe. The sixth is Perth, Western Australia. So tomorrow begins first in Western Australia. And with these new buses that prowl silently around the streets of Perth, we have had to devise new ways of training to equip the personnel to maintain those buses. There will also be new careers in the green economy, for example, carbon forensic accounting, making sure that the carbon records are accurate, and also probably new police work as well. So in other words, under this scenario, we go for a green economy, we seek to reinvent the economy and generate new jobs. Well, number 18, where to from here? Remember, we should not pick winners. If you start to pick a winner, then you are moving from possibility thinking across to preferences. So you've got to stick still with that scenario thinking. We need to create the indicators, and I've done that in some of my research projects. You need to develop contingency plans, and we've got to talk up these scenarios, what's called strategic conversation within the Shell organisation. The warning is that the pace of change will continue to increase, and so scenario thinking reduces the risk of being taken by surprise. It encourages us to develop contingency plans. We may not be able to predict the future, but we can plan for it. And we can embrace the future with confidence, knowing that whatever the future may throw at us, we can cope. For example, on the morning of 9/11, Channel 7 did a special coverage of the tragedy in New York, and I was obviously a part of that team. We interviewed a person who was running a hospital in New York, and the administrator said that only a few weeks ago they had done a bit of contingency planning for how they would cope with a major tragedy. And so they actually had confidence they could cope with 9/11 and the people being brought into casualty because they had done the training. It had given them a sense of confidence that they could cope with whatever the future would throw at them. So let me just conclude, therefore, by saying we've got four scenarios. The value of scenario thinking is it encourages us to think about the unthinkable. So it may well be that it's going to be business as usual, in which case just behave in a very financially cautious way and you'll be able to sail through this global financial crisis, knowing full well there'll be another one in a few more years to come. Or it may well be that this is a turning point in terms of a reallocation of the power at the global level. The United States is now beginning a decline, much the same way that Britain had begun its decline at the early part of the 20th century, and the same way that, of course, the Spanish, the Portuguese, the Dutch have also gone through their declines. It's now America's turn to decline, in which case we get ready for the rise of China and India. And, of course, for the first time in our history, we're no longer on the margins of history. We are there where the action is, because Asia is the region of the future. And we're there. We've got a front seat. So we're an Asian regional player. Or thirdly, perhaps that I'm just being too optimistic and this really is the end of the world, that perhaps the 2040s will see some sort of collapse of the global environment, that we will end up with nuclear terrorism, nuclear war, or whatever. And that therefore, we've only got a few more years left, perhaps not even that. If you follow the Mayan calendar, we've got just two more years left. On the other hand, the fourth scenario I try to offer is that, in fact, we're seeing an emergence of a new economy rising. In other words, the old industrial model that began in Great Britain in 1750 is changing, and a new environmentally based one is beginning to emerge. So what I've tried to do is to get you to start thinking about the unthinkable and the possibilities of change. Let me just conclude with a comment about what Governor Lachlan Macquarie would have thought of all this. Now, it's wrong to assume that we can interpret what historical figures would do today, because obviously our conditions are so different. But we do know that Macquarie was not overwhelmed by the task ahead of him, though it was clearly daunting. You know, imagine 200 years ago being said, well, you're not going to go to Australia. It's a journey which was dangerous in small ships lasting several months. It'd be like saying to somebody, well, we're not going to send you to the moon to run that. So he was not overwhelmed by the task. He was willing to take it on. As Geoffrey has said, he transformed the colony from a convict settlement to a thriving place of business. He encouraged economic activities, and again, as Geoff has said, the first bank, the Bank of New South Wales, now called Westpac, was created in his day. He saw government as an engine of change, and also he gave convicts a second go. At the display to which Geoff has referred in the library, there's a very interesting document about some of the people that he fell out with. And one of the major reasons that he fell out with the power brokers of his day was that he wanted to give convicts a second chance. And the establishment of his day said, no, if they're here as convicts, they stay as convicts. And he said, no, let's give them a second go. One of the people to whom he did give a second go was Edward Eager, who was a forger, therefore a crook, sent out here as a convict. He went on to create the Bank of New South Wales. Very appropriate, having a crook creating a bank, you'd feel at home in the United States at the moment. But he also went on to found the Methodist Church. And some of us in this audience this evening are associated with the church that he created on the rocks in Sydney in 1812. So Governor Macquarie is willing to give people a second go, and he was vindicated by that, even though he clashed with the power brokers of his day. And I think that in a sense, the global financial crisis needs bold action, the type that Governor Macquarie would recognise to this day. Because if you do what you've always done, then you will get what you've always got. And instead, what we've got to do is to think differently about the current crisis. In other words, we need to find ways that how we can make lemonade out of this lemon. Thanks very much.